Thank you, John. Hey, good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you again this morning, and we are going on our series on Lord, teach us to pray. Last week we talked about this, that this should be our prayer. This is a prayer for each one of us as we go through this six-week series, that the Lord will teach us to pray. I'm just so grateful for this disciple in Luke chapter 11 who just asked, Lord Jesus, teach us to pray. And we talked about that last week. Now today we are in the second bit of it. We are in the second bit of it about your kingdom come, your will be done. That's what we are going to talk. And you notice something. We are coming from adoration, what we talked about last week, to affirmation. We talked about our prayer should be, you know, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. It's more like an adoration. We are adoring him. We are declaring there is none like him. He's the only one who deserves our praise, our honor, all that we are, because he's the creator, he's the Father, and we talked about that. Now today we are coming out to the affirmation. We are affirming who he is, and we are saying, your kingdom come, your will be done. So let's start with the first thing about the kingdom come. What's all about this? The kingdom come. Now, the word kingdom is not common in this culture, in this American culture. This is not common, because when we think about a kingdom, what comes in our place is, in our mind, I mean, what comes in our mind is a place. We think of a kingdom as a place, like we might say the kingdom of Nepal, or we might say the United Kingdom of England, or some people have what they call the magic kingdom, you know, is this kingdom. Or that we think more of a place. This is a geographical place, something with the zip code, you know, or with the postal code attached to it. That's what comes in our mind. But the word kingdom in Greek, whereby we, our New Testament, we are getting from Greek, kingdom does not emphasize, does not talk about a place. It talks about a reign or a rule of a king, rather than a place that a king exercises that reign. That's the difference. That's key to get to really differentiate about the kingdom. That's the first thing that we need to nail down. That this is about the rule or the reign of this king, rather than a place where this king exercises his reign. In fact, some Bible translation, some of your Bible translation, they translate the kingdom of God as the reign of God or the rule of God. And you see, they just bring the idea home of the kingdom. Now, Jesus talked a lot about the kingdom of God. Very interesting when you study through the life of Jesus. His first sermon, his first recorded sermon in the Bible, it's in Matthew chapter 4, verses 17. And this is where he's starting. He is very early, you know, in his preaching, in his public life. And he comes along and he says, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. That's Matthew 4:17. That's pretty big. I think that's pretty big there. And this is the first thing. This is the first address. He's coming in the scene. He has been 30 years in this private life. Now he comes to the public life. And the first thing he says, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. For the reign, this rule of God has come near. He went ahead. Many of the stories, the parables that we know of Jesus Christ, he really talked about the kingdom. Many of the parables, they really illustrate about this kingdom of God. The Bible calls the Christian message about Jesus, that is the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Bible calls that the gospel of the kingdom. And you see something here, it's just to emphasize the importance, the value, the emphasis that our Lord Jesus Christ put on the emphasis of the kingdom. Jesus himself believed that through his life, through his death, God's name had descended upon the earth. That's what we see. That by his life and through his death, the name of God, which we are now, we call now the kingdom of God, the name of God had descended upon the earth. And somehow, by his death and the resurrection, God has opened door for this name, for this kingdom in his people. Yet, the same Jesus, yet he also taught that God's kingdom wouldn't come with power and authority until his second coming at the end of the age. That is the tension that you see there. And that's the tension that you see in the gospel. That he taught that even by his coming, by his life and his death, his kingdom has already come. In the best word the scholars like to use, has been inaugurated. By his life, by his death, this kingdom of God, this reign of God has been inaugurated here on earth. But you know, it will not be culminated now. It will be culminated when he appears, when he comes the second time. And all I'm trying to say with these brothers and sisters is that the message or the kingdom of God is at the center of Jesus' message. This is the heart of his message. And you see, because this is the heart. That's why even the second thing, before we bring any petition to him, Jesus told the disciples that when you pray, this is something else. This is something that's dear to me. I want you to pray about this. I want you to ask the Father to allow his kingdom, to allow his reign to come here on earth, because this is so dear to me. This is so valuable to me. I want this to be, you know, to be at the heart of you, to also pray about this. So this shows you and me that we need to pray for the advancement of this kingdom, the importance of this, because Jesus cared about it. Now, let's see some of the ways that we can pray for the kingdom of God to come. How is this kingdom of God can come real, can be seen in our real life situation, or how can we pray about it now? Because you said, pray about this, pray that the kingdom of God come. Now, are there ways that we can pray specifically that will come? Number one, the conversion of unbelievers. The conversion of unbelievers, praying that this non-believer, this person who have not accepted the reign of Christ, has not accepted him as Lord and Savior, praying that that person would do that. By doing that, by praying about that, what we are doing, we are asking the reign of God, the kingdom of God, to come in the life of that person. In other words, the kingdom come, this phrase, the kingdom come, is an evangelistic prayer. It is an evangelistic prayer. By praying that, Lord, let your kingdom come, what we are doing, we are asking the Lord to let, you know, to let Christ exercise his power in the heart of this believer. And so praying for the kingdom of or to come, in the sense, is praying for the salvation of the lost. And I want to encourage you, my dear brothers and sisters, to pray for those who have not accepted Jesus Christ in their lives. Because this is a need. This is by doing that, by praying that that will happen, what they will be doing, they are allowing the reign of Christ. They are allowing the kingdom, the rule, the reign of Christ in their lives. And so that's the first thing. That's the first thing. That when we pray that for the kingdom of God to come, what we are doing, the number one thing, we are praying for the conversion of these non-believers to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. The second thing that we are praying here is the commitment of believers. The desire of those who have already allowed Jesus Christ in their life, the desire to live out to that. The commitment, the desire to live out that for the fruit of the Holy Spirit to be seen in that. Paul said this. This is an interesting verse here. Paul in Romans 14:17 says this. That the kingdom of God, now the kingdom of God, what you have been taught, the reign of God, is not about eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Paul comes on the scene and says that the kingdom of God is not a matter about eating and drinking. It's not all about all those. But it's about bearing the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It's about righteousness. It's about peace. It's about joy. It's about love. It's about living the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And you see something precious, people. It's something that we can pray on a daily basis, that the kingdom of God will come in my life every single day by praying for the fruit of the Spirit to be manifested in me. And by doing that, I'm praying for the Holy Spirit, for the fruit of the Holy Spirit to be seen in me. And by doing that, I'm asking for the kingdom of God to come in my life. And the question for you, is the laying of Christ seen in you? Are you bearing the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace. And you can take time, you know, and just pray about that. And ask the Lord to help you. The commitment of a believer will be seen. Because by a commitment of a believer, the kingdom of God is in that person. The laying of God is in that person. How about praying for the commencement of the earthly kingdom? That our prayer should always involve that Lord, come and establish your kingdom. May I just give you some time and pray? You know, we are talking about prayers, but sometimes we talk about prayers and we don't spend time in prayers. May I give you 2 minutes and just think about that and pray about those three things. And ask the Lord to have his way in you. A life of an unbeliever, somebody that you know, that he has never given his life to Christ, ask the Lord to lay in the life of that person. Take time and ask the Lord to do that. As a believer, ask the Lord to intervene. Probably you are here, you have never given your life to Christ. That's the starting point, is to allow his lane, his kingdom in your life. Let's have that music in the background, JD.
Before my heart, before
just pray for your laying in us as believers. Help us to show that fruit of the Holy Spirit. And we pray for those we have mentioned to you, people, our loved one we know, and they have not allowed you as their Lord and Savior. We pray for their salvation today. We pray that they will allow you to be their Lord and Savior, to be their King, and that you are going to reign in their life. And Father, we pray, may you come and commence your kingdom. We are homesick for that. I am homesick for that, Lord. Yeah, when you come and reign and rule in righteousness, in peace, we don't have to worry about economy. You don't have to worry about the struggles, the things that worry us now. When you come back, wow, we can't wait for that, Lord. We give you praise. We give you honor. And thank you, because this is not all there is. There is that kingdom that we are waiting for you to come and establish here on earth. Father, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let's come now to the second bit of it. Yes, the kingdom come in those three areas, brothers and sisters. The kingdom come in the life of an unbeliever to accept Christ, in the commitment of a believer to allow the reign of Christ, and then in praying for the commencement of this other kingdom. And then finally we come to the will be done here on earth as is done in heaven. That this should be our prayer. That all in our prayer, that we should involve this, that it's not about your will, but it's about the will of God to be done. Now, when I think about the will of God to be done, I'm just reminded about Jesus Christ, his final moments before the crucifixion. His final moments before he died, you know, Jesus took his disciples to this private place, to the Garden of Gethsemane, to a private place to pray together. But what did the disciples do? The Bible tells us that he left the disciples and told them, you guys keep watch, pray, and just went further to pray. What did the disciples do? They fall asleep. I think this was the starting moment for Jesus to feel the loneliness that even his closest one are letting him down. And then he went and prayed this in Matthew 39. You have it there, J.D. Matthew 26 verses 39. It says this, that he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. You know, here we find Jesus, humanity, Jesus' human will struggling with the Father's will. There is that struggle. You know, Lord, I want to do your will, but if there is any other way that you can give the forgiveness, you can grant the forgiveness of sin, then Lord, use that. But you see, Jesus here is struggling. He knew his death is unique. You know, he knew what he's about to do. He is for the good, for the benefit of mankind. But yet he's struggling with this. He uses the word cup. That, Lord, take this cup from me. This is mostly coming from the Old Testament, talking about God's love. This is a word that's used in Old Testament. And Jesus knew this cup is going to go through God's love, God's judgment. Because all this, the humanity, the sin of mankind, is going to fall on him. You know, and he's judged by God. And so this is not a good moment. He knew what the Romans executioners, the Romans, are going to do to him. They were not kind. They were not to be kind. And he knew about Jesus. So Jesus Christ, go, Lord, I want to do your will, but if there is any other way, you can take this cup from me and just fulfill your will in something else. Lord, just do it, but Lord, not my will, but as you will. You see, brothers and sisters, the Bible records that Jesus repeated that three times. This was not like, Lord, if it's your will, just, you know, this is in agony, in pain. He knew what he was going through three times. But what does he conclude by doing? He concludes by surrendering his will to God's will. Now, what does this tell you and me, brothers and sisters? From this, we can get something that when we pray for God's will to be done, we are affirming, I think you have it there, we are affirming our desire to follow Jesus' example. As believers, as followers of Christ, this should be our prayer. The Lord, I am committing these needs to you. I'm committing these wants to you. You know what I'm going through. But Lord, as your follower, I am following, I'm surrendering this to you. And by doing that, by surrendering to God what you are affirming that desire to follow the example of Jesus Christ. I want to encourage you. I know, and you see, the interesting bit with this prayer is because it's before the wants, before the needs. You see, this is what we see on top of it, is the adoration and the affirmation. Before coming, give us today our daily bread, which we are going to see in a couple of next few weeks. So before he comes to that, this is what he's affirming, that shum, you know, I am setting an example. He set an example for you and for me to follow, to want to affirm that, Lord, we are following you. And no matter what I'm going through, I want your will to be done. I want your will to be done in this situation. I want to encourage you and myself as followers of Jesus Christ that our desire will be for the will of God to be done in the situation. Just that surrender. Yeah, you might mention your wants, your need, but the bottom line, brothers and sisters, the bottom line, Lord, let your will be done in this. And I'll tell you the reason. The reason, brothers and sisters, because he knows what's best for you. Remember, we are addressing our Father. That was the starting point. And we saw from last week that our Father, he is more than our fathers here on earth. Remember we read that passage whereby that, you know, as a daddy, as a father, you cannot ask a son, a daughter cannot ask you to give him a fish and give him a snake. You know, you can't do that. And just conclude that if you guys and you are evil, you know how to do good things to your kids, how about your heavenly Father who is righteous? You see, the bottom line, brothers and sisters, is to surrender to the will of God because he knows what's best for us. Sometimes we think we know what's best for us. But have you sometimes made prayers and then the Lord doesn't answer, and then you are just so grateful that the Lord didn't answer those prayers? I have done that. And you're just so grateful. And this is just, that's the bottom line, is to surrender to the will of God. And I see that Jesus did set an example for us to follow, is that we are affirming, Lord, I don't know better. You know the future. You hold the foundation of this world. And so what I'm doing, I'm surrendering this to you. Your Father, I just want your will to be done. Number two here, in John, 1 John 5:14. We see our second affirmation there. 1 John 5:14-15 says this, that this is the confidence which we have before him, talking about prayers, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. That's one thing there. That's the realized there. That if we ask anything according to his will, he does hear us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we have asked from him. That's good. That's just a good verse there. And I just want to expound something there. The Apostle John here is just expressing the boldness and the confidence that we have in approaching God. By the way, the author of Hebrews also talks about this, that we don't come, you know, on the throne trembling or fearing, but we come with confidence. And this is the encouragement for every believer, that we don't come on the throne, we don't come in prayers fearing or trembling, but we come with confidence. And so this is the deal here, and says that we have whatever we want because God hears. Now the word here, you have it there on JD, I think. So John is not implying that God doesn't hear our prayers if we ask for things outside his will. out of his will. But he is saying God responds positively to our request only when those requests are aligned with God's will. Let me come back to that. So the word here means to respond positively. So if we are to look at the word here from the original meaning, is to respond positively. The idea of responding positively. So John is not implying that God doesn't hear our prayers if we ask for things outside. So we may ask things outside of God's will, but John is not implying that God doesn't hear them. No. He hears those things even if they are not, they are outside his will. That's the idea. John is not implying that God doesn't hear. He hears all our prayers. By the way, we are his children and he knows, you know, things that we ask. By the way, you read Matthew says that even before we ask, he even knows what we are going to ask. So John is saying, but he is saying God responds positively, here this is the deal, to our request only when those requests are aligned in God's will. So this is the key. We can absolutely be sure we get what we want from God when we pray according to God's will. You can be sure of that. That we are praying according to God's will, then we can get what we want. And this is the teaching. This is the second thing that we are affirmed. When we pray for God's will to be done, we are affirming our trust in God to answer our requests appropriately. That's what we are doing. When we are praying for God's will to be done, while that we are affirming our trust in Him. We are affirming our trust in God to answer our request appropriately. Now, when you ask for something, there are three possible answers that God will give you. Three. One, yes. That one we know. You know, Lord, that's the reason why you are praying. You want a less in this. So yes, you know, God will grant that request. The second one is no, which we don't like. Is no, and God says no to that. And sometimes He says not now. So those three are the possible answers that you receive in prayers. Not now, you know, not now. Just wait for some things. I'm making some things out, but it's not now. So every request we make to God is answered in one of those ways. You know what, brothers and sisters? There are no unanswered prayer for God's children. And that should be an encouragement to you to go to God all the time in prayers. Because every time you make a prayer to God, it's either a yes, it's either a no. Not a no that He doesn't care or He doesn't love you, but a no because He loves you so much that He don't want to spoil you or to do something, you know, with that no. Or not yet. Just wait. I'm maturing. I'm making things out. Just wait. There's something I'm doing. So we are saying, God, that this is what I want to do, what I think I need to do in this situation. But I'm trusting that you trust and believe the situation that God sees. He has a way. There are no unanswered prayer. I listened to a song the other day. This was an interesting one. Probably you have heard it by Garth Brooks. And the song goes, Unanswered Prayer. Have you heard that song? The song goes, for those who have never heard the song. The song goes this, that there was this reunion, high school reunion, and he sees the woman that when they were young, when they were in high school, he sees this lady that he wanted to marry that lady. And he used to pray and ask God, Lord, just make a way that I marry this girl. But it never came to be, and so when they met after the reunion, God finishes the song by saying that he was so grateful after the reunion. He was so grateful that God never allowed him to marry that girl, but he married the wife that he has. You see, the whole deal here, you might think that God did not answer that prayer. But you see, God answered the prayer, but he answered with a no. By the way, that should not be taken out of context that way, an example.
So the idea is that it was answered, but it was answered with a no. And that's the whole deal. God knows what's best for us. Everyone should be the bottom line, brothers and sisters. He knows what's the best for us. And all that we need to do is to align ourselves in God's will. He knows what he's doing. Ours is to come to him, is to come to him in prayers. But, you know, we trust. He knows what he's doing. May I encourage you, because when we pray everything according to God's will, he promises to answer. He promises to respond positively. So when we pray for the will of God, number one thing that we are doing, we are surrendering our will to him. He knows what's best for us. But then we are affirming, he's going to respond. We are affirming our trust in him that he's going to respond positively in whatever things that we are making. Brothers, as I conclude, when we pray for God's kingdom to come, we are praying for the fulfillment of God's rule on earth in these three things. In the conversation of the unbelievers, in the commitment of believers, and in the commencement of God's earthly kingdom. And when we pray, the other one, JD, when we pray for them, you have the other slides there. When we pray for God's will to be done, we are making this affirmation. These are the affirmations that we are making. We are affirming our desire to follow Jesus Christ. Follow the example of Christ. Even in that painful, by the way, none of you is going to go through the pain, the struggle that our Lord Jesus Christ went through. At that night, when he knew what was waiting him, the separation from Father, none of you is going to go through that. But you see, even at that darkest moment of his life, he was willing to say, Lord, not my will, but let your will. May I encourage you? I know there are struggles, there are difficulties, there are things that we want our will. But let's surrender as followers of Christ. Let's affirm the Lord, I want to follow you. Even in this difficult situation, I want your will to be done. And then we are affirming our trust in God to answer our request, our prayers in line according to his will. May the Lord help us as we come to the Lord in prayer. My encouragement to you is this week, surrender to the will of God. You see, that's what we have seen so far. We are adoring him and we are affirming who he is. He knows better. He has the best interest for each one of us. And all we can do is to adore him and is to affirm him, to allow his name even before we come to our request, before we come to make our request, what we are going to see in a couple of weeks. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We pray that you continue to teach us to pray. We want to spend more time with you. We don't want to feel guilty about our prayer life. And our prayer, Lord, is that we will do this. We will spend more time praying for your kingdom to come. And you have shown us what that includes. And then to surrender our will to you, because you have the best interest for each one of us. And I pray for my dear brothers and sisters here, that we will spend more time, because this is what you are teaching us, Lord. We spend more time in adoring you, in giving you honor, in spending time with you to hallow your name, to honor you, to revere you, to pray for your interest, even before we come to our own. Because when we do that, when we spend more time in that, our needs, our wants shrinks and they even become insignificant because of this big picture that we have in you. Father, we thank you. Thank you so much for my dear brothers and sisters here. The Lord, you know the needs that have been mentioned today, that are laced here of people who are struggling with their health, people who are struggling financially here. And Lord, I just pray for you to meet them at the point of their need. We know through prayers you intervene, you work things out. And Lord, I just pray that you please work in the needs of each and every person in this church. Those who they're struggling health-wise, their friends, their families. I just pray that, Lord, you please touch them at in their health. Those who are struggling financially, Lord, just intervene and help them even to make wise decisions in areas of finances. I just pray that, Lord, you just encourage each one of us. We surrender ourselves to you, that your will be done. We pray for your kingdom to come.
and for thy will to be done today and days to come. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed week.